हाय अपर्णा, गुड मॉर्निंग.
गुड मॉर्निंग, नमस्ते. हाँ,
नमस्ते. सो गाइस, इट्स अ प्लेजर टू बी हियर ऑन आवर थर्ड एडिशन ऑफ रीसेट योगा वीकेंड्स. सो दिस इज अ कंटिन्यूस सीरीज वेयर वी ब्रिंग द बेस्ट ऑफ द योगीज, द योगिनीज, टू इम्पार्ट दैट 1 आवर सुपर एक्सरसाइज, सम आसनास, कॉन्शियस ब्रीदिंग एंड मेडिटेशन टू रीसेट योर वीकेंड्स. इट्स अ बिग आई मीन इट्स अ बिग थिंग टुडे बिकॉज आई हैव माय डियर फ्रेंड एंड कंपेनियन अपर्णा मोरे, योगिनी अपर्णा मोरे, एंड आई एम थ्रिल्ड टू इंट्रोड्यूस हर. इट्स बीन अ काइंड ऑफ अ ग्रेट जर्नी फॉर अपर्णा, एंड टू जस्ट प्रेजेंट टू यू हर क्रेडेंशियल्स. शी हैज कंप्लीटेड हर डिप्लोमा इन योगा एजुकेशन फ्रॉम इंडिया यूनिवर्सिटी. शी इज 200 आवर्स यूएस योगा अलायंस टीचर्स ट्रेनिंग कोर्स, a certified aerial fitness teacher, a certified reiki trainer, and she is also a certified in ayurveda and naturopathy, and she has been a brand ambassador for kids yoga from us. So it's a lot of it's kind of now 5 years that she is teaching and living yoga. The best part is that she was a recipient of the Indian Icon Woman Personality for her contribution towards yoga. And that was in June 2019. And one of the 10 women, very interesting aspect of Aparna, which we will discuss during the Q&A, is she was selected from about 50,000 Everest, people who were shortlisted for the Everest Base Camp. And she was one of the 10 to be with Jamling Tenzing Norgay. She has international experience, and she has been imparting the beauty and the magic of yoga at the Coventry Volunteer Association. She was in Myanmar to spread the magic of yoga with tourists there, locals, teachers, and students. And she was also in Malaysia, where she had a studio independently. So it's all over to you, Aparna. I mean, I'm sure people will get a lot of takeaways today. And it's been, 1 hour is too short for the kind of experience which you carry. We are all looking forward to the next 1 hour from you, Aparna. It's all over to you.
Thank you, Shailesh. Good morning and namaste all. It's my great privilege to be part of Sense 22 Yoga and have you all here with me to be live on Facebook this weekend and connecting us through a common thread, which is you. Now, before I get started, I just wanted to spend few seconds on actually letting you know the importance of Namaskar Mudra, because the way we start always now in the lieu of pandemic, now this is the way we meet and greet people with the Namaskar Mudra. Now this is a profound hand gesture, and there's so much of intelligence that has gone beyond it, which we actually are not aware of it. Okay, now when we are doing a Namaskar Mudra, there are multiple nerve endings at our fingertips. So when we do that, we are actually activating those fingertips, which actually invigorates each and every organ in our body, as every nerve has some organs associated with it. So that's the most important thing of this hand gesture, Namaskar Mudra. The other important part is, as you all know, our right hand, it represents the left brain hemisphere, and the left hand represents the right brain hemisphere. So when you're joining both the palms together, you're actually activating both the hemispheres of your brain, increasing the efficiency of the brain. Okay. And the third important aspect is, now it's a general human tendency. Now, when we meet people, now even when you are, you know, watching me live, there's so much of judgment that goes behind our mind, like, you know, the way I'm talking, the way I'm presenting, the way I'm dressed. And it's very natural and normal because it's based on our past experiences. But when we join our palms together, we actually dissolve all these dualities, because we know that there's a soul inside me which actually is in connection with the soul with you. So all those dualities are resolved. So that's the importance of this profound hand gesture, Namaste, which I thought I should share with you, because this is the way going forward. This is the way how we are going to meet and greet people. And when you understand and do it, there's so much of energy that gets generated. So once again, Namaste to you. A soul in me honors the soul in you. Okay, now coming to the program, I'll just explain you in brief what will be the flow of our program, and then we'll get started. Okay. So we'll start by chanting Om for 5 times. After that, I'll tell you 5 basic exercises. It's very simple asanas, okay, which you can do every day. And once you do just this 5 asanas, you're like, you know, set for the day. Because it not only works on your physical aspect, but it also works on your inner organs by activating that. And as we do each and every asana, I'll explain it to you how it helps you. Okay. After the asana, we will do few eye exercises, because the way we are now exposed to the digital technology, you know, eyes are the important part that gets affected very badly. So we'll focus or we'll do few eye exercises. After that, we'll come to breathing, and then we'll do a little bit of relaxation and conclude the session. So this will be the flow of the event today. Okay. Definitely, if you have any questions, any comments, you can always keep on putting it over here. So we start by chanting Om. Now, again, before getting into chanting the Om, most of you must be knowing the significance of Om. It's basically a universal sound. It's a universal sound that binds us together. And Om is made of 3 syllables, A, U, Ma. To put it in English, A, U, M. Now, what does this syllable stand for? When you say A or A, it's basically accepting every situation that comes in your life, because that's the perfect thing for you at this time. Okay, so A stands for accept. U stands for understanding. So whatever situation, whatever event is happening in your life now, okay, just understand it's for your highest good. Okay, just take an example of this event. You know, it's all planned. And you know, it's happening for the highest good of myself as well as highest good for you all. So that is you in Om. And the last syllable, M or M, it stands for merge. So when you accept any situation, all the events in your life, you understand it's for your highest good, then definitely you merge with the divine. So that's what Om stands for. So when you're chanting Om, just inculcate these things what I'm explaining it to you. Because when your thoughts flow to what you're doing, the energy, your prana flows to that area. And you know, it actually refreshes the entire cells in your body. Yes, the word Om reaches every cell in your body. Okay. So let's get started by chanting Om. Sit in any comfortable position. Okay. If you feel it's difficult for you, if there are senior citizens, use chair, even that is fine. Okay. The only thing is your spine should be completely erect. That's the only requirement which I will have throughout the session. An erect spine and a smile on your face. Okay. These are the just 2 requirements. So sit in any comfortable position. Hands are in Gyan Mudra. Gyan Mudra is where your index finger is touching the tip of your thumb. Okay, you rest this mudra on your knees. Now, the importance of this mudra, it gets you to the present. Now, our mind constantly is wandering. So when you do this, you are directed to the present moment, which we need to seize it. Okay, so hands in Gyan Mudra, roll back your shoulders, spine erect. You can just close your eyes for a few seconds. Take a few moments here. Get an awareness of your breath. Now let's chant Om to get you to the time and space on your magic carpet, which is your yoga mat. Okay, so inhale. Mm-hmm. And relax. Slowly open your eyes. Feel the vibrations of this mantra preparing you, your mind, your body, for the next set of asana. Now slowly, just release your hand gesture, hand mudra, dhyana mudra. Release your legs, just release your legs. You can straighten it. If you're sitting on a chair, just be as is. Just ensure your spine is erect. Your hands are by the side. And let's do just ankle movements. So in and out movement of your ankle. Few ankle movements here. You're just activating, you're just waking up each and every part of your body. Now just rotate your ankles. One, two, three, four, five. Now opposite direction, one, two, three, four, five. Now just take here one ankle in and other ankle out. So stretch one ankle and flex other ankle. Change. 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 Change, change, and change. Good. Now we are going to stand up. I just want to show you one way of standing up, and I want you to try if you can stand that way without taking the support. Okay? If you can't do it, that's okay. Just take the support and stand up. But if you can stand up like this, just cross your legs and just come up without any support. If you can do that, stand up in this way, not only today, every time, okay? Because that increases the agility of your body. If you're not able to do, that's perfectly fine. Don't worry, you'll get there slowly, okay? Now, let's go to the main five asanas that I'll be talking about, okay? Now, these are the five asanas which you can do every day, okay? And if you do this every day, I mean, even if you don't do any other things, that's completely fine, okay? So the first asana is Tad Asana. Tad is mountain in Sanskrit, so it's a mountain pose. Now, the way you get into this asana, little bit distance between your feet, basically shoulder width apart, okay? Now, arms by the side. Now, as you inhale, okay? So you are basically interlocking your fingers, okay? You inhale, take your arms up, interlock your fingers and pull yourself up. So you're coming on your toes and pull yourself nicely up. You should feel there's an opening on the entire side. It's like you're pulling yourself up. So just be here, keep breathing. Five, four, three, two, one, to release, inhale. As you exhale, slowly come down. If there are any senior citizens or if you feel it's difficult for you to balance, just take the support of a wall or a cupboard and you can just come up on your toes and hold here. Okay, see what works for you, because every body is different, every individual is different. Okay, so this was Tadasana. Now the most important aspect of every asana is to do it with the coordination of your breath. Okay, so like when I am getting into the asana, I am inhaling. When I get into the asana, I exhale and I keep breathing here. Okay, I just keep taking few deep breaths here. And when you want to release, you just inhale and then you exhale. Okay, so every time when you do yoga, ensure that you do it with your breathing. Okay, because that's the way you give your body what it needs the most, the oxygen. Okay, now the first one, this was Tadasana. Now the way it helps you, okay, you would have realized it opens up your entire body. You're actually stretching your entire body. There's a nice vertical stretch to the body. Okay, apart from that, you're strengthening your toes, your ankles, your shins, your calf muscles. Calf muscles are very important because at the lower part of the body, those are the muscles that actually direct the blood to the heart. So basically, calf muscles are called as second heart, because in the lower body, those organs direct the blood to the heart. Okay. So, and that part is generally neglected. You know, we never focus on the calf muscles. So this Tadasana will help you in strengthening those muscles. Okay. So this was the first asana, which opens up your entire body and gives you a nice vertical stretch. Okay. Now the second asana that you need to do is Kati Chakrasana. Kati means waist in Sanskrit and Chakrasana means twisting. I'll show it to you first, then we can do it. Okay. So you increase the distance between your feet. Okay. Maybe towards the end of your mat. You can take your feet towards the end of the mat. Now arms are straight. Okay. Now you inhale. Now what, as you exhale, what you're doing is I'm taking my one arm around my waist and the other arm, I'm twisting and taking it on my shoulder. So you see there's a nice twist to my spine. Okay, this way. I'll show it to you from the back. So when I'm standing like this, I inhale, one arm goes around the waist, other arm is on my shoulder and I'm twisting completely. Okay, so let's do this. Before that, let me tell you how it works so that when you are doing it, just visualize internally yourself and do it. Now, what I'm doing, I'm twisting my spine. When I'm twisting my spine, we are engaging two most important detox players in our body. Okay, so that is liver and pancreas. Okay, this is the position of liver and pancreas. So when you twist, you're actually engaging those organs. And because of that, you know, pancreas secretes bile. So what happens when you do this, the bile is secreted and the sugar in your body is balanced because the insulin is released. Okay. When the insulin is released and when you do a twist, you're balancing the sugar in the body. So a very effective asana for people who have sugar or who are diabetic, and also for general public because it is balancing the entire sugar in the blood. Okay. So you are actually stimulating your pancreas, your liver, and all the internal abdominal organs because you're giving it a nice twist. Okay. The second most important feature of this asana is whenever you do any twist, not only this twist, whenever you twist, you start on the detoxification process because as I told you, the important detox players are involved. Okay. So it's also very good for the digestion. Okay. So now when you're doing this, go internally, visualize internally or internalize yourself and see how your pancreas and liver are getting a nice twist and they are being worked upon and squeezed, you know, to work to their optimal level. Okay, come on. Now let's get into this asana. Distance between your feet. Now, if again, there are senior citizens, if you feel doing this requires a little bit of balance, keep your hands on your waist and you can just twist this way. Again, see what works for you. Arm straight. Now inhale. As you exhale, Twist your spine. One arm goes around your waist, other arm around your shoulder, and twist as much as you can. Feel that twist. Feel that a nice swinging of your internal organs. Inhale to the center. Exhale here. Now let's do the other side. Again, inhale. As you exhale, one arm around your waist and other arm on your shoulder and twist as much as you can. Again, you can hold here, but when you are holding, just hold the asana, not the breath. You have to continue to breathe. So you can breathe here. Say for 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Inhale, come up. And relax. Okay. Now this holding the asana, again, you know, you can start with 10 seconds, 5 seconds, and then slowly increase it to 30 seconds. So gradually increase the time every day. The more time you be in the asana, the better you feel and the deeper you go. Okay? So gradually increase your timings to be in the asana. So this was the second asana. First, Tadasana Mountain, a nice vertical stretch. Okay, shaking and waking up each and every organ in your body. Second, spinal twist or Kati Chakrasana. Now activating the most important detox players in our body and working on the internal entire abdominal area. Okay. Now the third asana is the forward bend. Okay. Now here again, I'll show it to you. Okay, before that, let me just tell you a little bit about forward bend. Forward bend, now people who have, you know, back pain or, mostly back pain, go down very slowly. Or if you feel you need to go to the certain limit and stop, do it. Because you know your body well, so do it very slowly. Okay. Now the way you do it is, again, your feet are just towards the end of the mat. Arms on your waist. Now, whenever you're standing, always tuck in your abdomen. So generally, we stand with the protruding abdomen. Just tuck in your abdomen. So when you tuck in, your spine automatically straightens. Okay. Hands on your waist. You keep looking straight. Now, whenever we bend forward to pick up anything, you know, how do we do it? So it's generally, you know, we just do it like this, where the knees are bent and you're collapsing your spine. You're just going down immediately. That's the wrong way because you're actually making the vertebrae at the spine to collapse on each other, okay? So when you do a forward bend, ensure you do it this way. Okay, again, spine erect, look straight. Now inhale. And as you exhale, what I'm doing? I'm lending my spine. I'm going ahead with my sternum. And then I'm taking my head in as much as you can. Okay, you be here for say 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and come slow. Okay. So whenever you get into the forward bend, first lengthen your spine. How do you lengthen? By taking it ahead with your sternum, with your chest muscle, and then you go down. Now, when you do this in a right way, you'll get a nice stretch on the back of your legs. So that way you're working on your entire lower back, your spine, as well as your legs. Okay, so let's do it one more time and focus your attention where you're getting the stretch, back of the legs and the lower back. Okay, do it in the right way, not only today, henceforth, start doing forward bend in this way. Okay, so arms on your waist. Okay, abdomen tucked in, inhale. As you exhale, keep looking straight first, lengthen your spine. And then take your head in, neck in as much as you can. Focus your attention on the back of your legs. We are getting a nice, good, deep stretch. Inhale, come up. Okay. So now the advantages of doing this forward bend. Physical aspects, as I told you, it works on the back. It strengthens the leg muscles. It gives a nice stretch to the spine. And we all know we are as young as spine. Okay. So it's very important to keep our spine straight and healthy all the time. Okay, now these are the physical aspects. When you talk about the internal aspects, okay, what happens is when you bend forward, you're directing your blood flow to your brain and eyes area. So there's a nice blood flow to your brain area and the entire face area. Okay, so this is also an anti-aging asana, okay, because you're giving a nice flow of blood to your face. Okay. So that's one aspect. Second is it also strengthens the eye muscles because there's a nice blood flow to the eye area too. Okay. And the third most important aspect is when you do a forward bend, okay, you'll see my head goes down compared to my heart position. Okay. Now, whenever you do any asana where you see that your head is going down compared to the heart position, it's the best immunity booster asana. And you know why? Because when you bend forward and your head goes down, okay, there are white blood corpuscles, okay, which are the soldiers in our body. The efficiency of that increases because there's a nice blood flow, okay, and because of which the immunity power of the body starts increasing. So a forward bend is very effective for increasing the immunity, okay. So now when you do all these asanas, keep these things in your mind, where you're working, how it's helping you, not only in a physical aspect, but also the internal organs. Okay. And just remember what happens for most of the people when they do a forward bend and hold there for longer time, say 20 seconds or 30 seconds. And when you come up, you have to just be stable for a few seconds, you know, let the blood settle down because you have directed your blood flow to the entire upper part of the body. And sometimes people may get dizziness if you come up immediately and start moving around. Okay. So just give at least a minute for the blood to settle down and then do go ahead with your regular activity. Okay. So that was forward bend, third asana. Okay. Now the fourth asana opposite to that, which is backward bend. Okay. Now again here, people who have any lower back issues, okay, do it slowly. It's not that you should avoid it completely, but do it very slowly and stop at a certain level where you feel that you shouldn't be going ahead. Your body gives you signals, your body directs you, your body tells you when to push, your body tells you when to stop. You have to be attentive. That's what yoga is all about. Be present in the moment. Listen to your body. Okay. So the fourth asana, back bend. Again, the position of the legs remains same, okay? Keep your arms on your waist. You inhale. As you exhale, push yourself and bend back. Now again here, go down as much as you can. Once you go down, just hold there for a few seconds and slowly come, okay? So let's do it together and then I'll talk about its benefits. Arms on your waist. Again, abdomen tucked in, spine erect, look straight. Inhale. As you exhale, start bending back slowly and go down as much as you can. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and come. So that was back bending. Now back bending, again, a very important asana because we never get into a back bending. It's always a forward bend, you know, and with this digital world, you know, with a phone in our hand, our necks are constantly hanging down. Okay. So backward bend, which is not common nowadays, this asana needs to be done every day because your entire spine, neck and shoulder areas, you know, it's like it's always being in the forward movement, creating a lot of stress and tension in this area without we even realizing it. Only when it gets to that limit where, you know, it starts aching, then we start realizing it. So the backward bend, a very important asana, a must do asana every day. Okay. Now, again, as you know, the physical benefits works on your entire back, opens up your chest and shoulder muscles, you know. Most of the times we are slouching, you know, either in a sitting position or with the cell in our hand, the position of the shoulders and the chest are always slouched in. Okay. So now this asana, it opens up your entire chest and shoulder muscles. Other important aspect of this asana is it works on the heart chakra. Okay, there are different chakras in our body. That's a totally different thing which we will cover through Sense 22 Yoga as we move ahead. But then the most important aspect is it works on the heart chakra, which opens up the heart chakra. Okay, very good for people who have thyroid. It works on the thymus glands over here, which are on the neck, which are at the neck. So it opens up that. So it's also very good for people who have thyroid, who have back pain issues, who have problems with the spine. Okay. So this was the fourth asana. Okay. So you see, these are all easily and doable asanas and will not take much of a time. But you know the immense benefits it has, not only on the physical aspects, but also on your internal organs. Okay. Now the fifth asana that you need to do every day is balancing asana. Okay. Now balancing asana, again, if there are senior citizens, take the support of a wall and do it. Okay. You can just do this and just bend forward. If there are intermediate, they can get into a tree pose. Okay, so the tree pose is you just take your heels to your pelvic area and get into Namaskar Mudra at the top. Okay, this is Vrikshasana, tree pose or balancing asana. Okay, now again, an important asana. Because when you get into a balancing asana, you're not just balancing your body, you're balancing all the emotions within yourself. Okay, so that is the emotional benefit that you get when you stay into the balancing asana for longer time. Okay, the other important advantage is, so this is the balancing pose. Okay, you're strengthening your entire lower body. Okay, you're strengthening your knees, ligaments, tendons. Okay, you're strengthening your entire feet. Okay, now again, you're making a Namaskar Mudra at the top, and I've explained you the importance of Namaskar Mudra already at the start of the beginning. At the start of the session, sorry. Okay, so that's the way you get into the asana. Okay, and when you're balancing yourself, there are so many emotions that are balanced within you. Okay, and when you get into this tree pose, why it's called a tree pose? Because it inculcates in us the feeling of being strong, stable, and ability to withstand any weather. Okay, so whatever situations come in your life, if you are balanced, you'll be able to handle that situation. Okay, so that's the importance of the balancing asana. Now, all the balancing asanas work on each and every nerve in your body, so it works on your entire nervous system. Just imagine this simple balancing asana. You know, it's strengthening your entire nervous system. Okay. And then once you're done with one leg, you also need to repeat it with the other leg. Okay. So again, you can do this. Okay. And then you can just be here for a few seconds. You focus at a point to get the balance. Initially, if you're doing it for first time, you may feel that, you know, you're off balance. That's okay. Take a point. Focus at a point and you'll get the balance. Okay. You can be here and then come out. Okay. So again, to start with 15 seconds, 30 seconds. Slowly set a timer for 1 minute and do it. Okay. And now when you're doing it, just see that, you know, you have that feeling that, yes, I am strong, stable and grounded. The way the trees are grounded and stable. Okay. Similarly, see internally that your nerves are getting strengthened. Okay. So my purpose of explaining all these things while doing the asana is I want you to remember these things. Maybe not all, but yes, definitely a few things like a tree pose. You know what does tree stand for? Being strong, stable, and withstanding any weather conditions. Okay. So you can accordingly imagine yourself to be in that position when you get into the asana. Okay, so these are the 5 asanas that I wanted to share with you, and I wanted you to do it every day. We'll just have a quick recap. Okay, first one, Tadasana, the mountain pose, where you completely lengthen yourself vertically, coming on your toes. Okay, good for the entire body, opening up the body, opening up the entire spine and the thoracic area. Okay. Second one, we did the twists. Okay, Kati Chakrasana. Now, very important to balance the sugar in the blood. You are starting the detoxification process in your body. Okay, because you are actually twisting your spine. Very good for the entire digestive system. Okay. Third one, forward bend. Good for the immunity. Also strengthening your back and legs. Fourth, backward bend. Very good for the circulatory system near the heart, because it opens up your chest and shoulder muscles. Okay, also strengthens the upper body. Fifth, works on your entire nervous system because you're balancing the body. So you see, with these five asanas, you're actually working on all the systems in your body. And they're pretty simple and doesn't take much time. Start slowly with 15 to 20 seconds. Once you're comfortable, increase your timings to 45 seconds or 1 minute, whatever works for you. Okay. So these were the five asanas that I wanted to share with you. There are two more which I think I should share with you. Okay. So the first one is, now this won't be possible for all the people to do it. Okay. It's called Malasana. Okay. So especially senior citizens who have knee issues, don't do this. Okay. But others who have been doing it or who are, you know, hale and hearty, please do it and start doing it from today, because if you do it, you'll never have any knee problems. This is a guarantee from me, not from me, from you. Okay. So do it every day and you will never have any knee problems and also the digestion problems. Okay. So now the way you get into the asana is, you take your feet little bit apart, hands in Namaskar Mudra. And now what you do is, you are just sitting down. Our Indian toilet pose, Malasana, garland pose. The body is representing a garland. A very effective asana. If you are able to sit like this for 5 minutes, just be assured your knees are in perfect condition and you're not going to get any problems in any age for the knees, because it's strengthening your ligaments, tendons, and the joints of the entire leg. So here, initially when you try, no, there's a tendency that you lean forward, which is okay if you're doing it for the first time, but see to it your spine is erect. You use your elbows to push your knees and look straight. Okay. Again, a very beautiful asana. You know, there's so much of intelligence that has gone behind the customs that we used to have. The Indian toilet pose, you know, when you're sitting like this, there's a nice pressure on your entire digestive system. Okay. Which takes all the mal. That's why it's called Malasana. It takes all the mal, or, you know, the toxins in our body and directs it to the alimentary canal for the excretion. Okay. But nowadays, because of the Western toilet, we are not used to sitting like this. But I would suggest start again with 10 seconds. Sit every day. If you are into habit of drinking warm water in the morning, take a glass, drink water in this direction, in this asana. Okay. So what happens, the water exactly goes down through your throat, to your stomach, and passes through every layer of your intestine. You know, the small intestine and the large intestine, it pushes all the toxins or the feces that are accumulated in that to the rectum, through which it is excreted out. Okay. And then it's like a complete clean out. It's like a dry clean of your entire abdominal area. So if you can drink warm water sitting in this position every morning, it's going to benefit you a lot, not only from your knees perspective, but also from your digestion issues. Okay. So this was Malasana. Again, you know, people with knee issues completely avoid it. Okay. Others start doing it starting with 5 seconds, 10 seconds. Okay. Great. Now just come down, sitting position. Sorry. Okay, so remember this five asanas that we did in the standing position. Malasana is an additional thing which you can incorporate, especially in the mornings while having your warm water. Just sit in that position and have it. You'll start seeing the difference very soon. Okay, now again, sit down in any comfortable position. Let's just do two eye exercises. Okay, there are many. I'll just share few of it with you. Okay. Now, the first exercise is very simple. You can just do it even when you're sitting and watching TV, or you know, you're just traveling in a car, or just sitting and talking with anyone, you can just do it. So the way you do it is, you first shut your eyes tightly. Okay. So you shut your eyes tightly and then open it wider. Okay, shut, open, shut, open, shut, open. Okay, just shutting your eyes very tightly. You should feel that little bit of pressure around your eyes area. Okay, and then open it wider. Now, when you're doing it, you're working on the nerves. When you're opening the eyes wider, you're actually working on the internal sockets of your eyes, which are actually being, you know, open and close. Okay, open and close. So it helps in strengthening those eye muscles. Okay, so this is one exercise. Other exercise, you know, most of them anyways keep doing it, you know, just gazing at one point without blinking your eyes. So you can either hold your thumb and look in between the thumbs, or you can just take one point which is in front of you and keep gazing without blinking your eyes. Okay, your eyes may hurt, it may water also, but then that's a normal thing to do. It's a normal thing. So you can just be there, gaze at one point, try not to blink your eyes. Even if you blink, you can start gazing there again. And relax. I was blinking actually. Okay. So you can do these two exercises. There are many. We'll start. We'll anyways keep on talking about it as we get into many more sessions through Sense 22. Okay. Now, after you're done with eye exercises, just warm your palms nicely. Remember, there's so much of energy within our palms. There are so many nerve endings in the palms. So what you're doing is, by doing this, you're actually concentrating the energy in your palms. And then you close your eyes and take this warmth and darkness to your eyes. Just cover your eyes with this warmth and darkness and blink your eyes in this warmth for a few seconds. Just blink your eyes in this darkness and warmth. And relax. Sorry. Okay. So this you can keep doing if you're working from home on the laptop. Just take a few seconds and, you know, just blink and blink your eyes tightly, open it wider, shut it tightly, and then just gaze at a point. You can just keep doing this after 2 or 3 hours every time. It's very good to increase the moisture in your eyes and to strengthen the eye muscles. Okay. Now, let's get into a breathing. We are not going to get into a hardcore breathing. We are not going to get into a pranayam immediately. Okay, we'll take a little, a little slow approach. Okay, so today we'll just start with one type of breathing, which is Siha Mudra. Okay, now Siha Mudra or a lion pose. Okay, it looks funny. Okay, but it's a very effective. It's a very effective mudra. Okay. Now here, what you do is basically, you know, you actually first inhale, you take out your tongue. I'll show it to you. Take out your tongue, exhaling through the throat and gaze at the tip of the nose. So you're basically squinting. Okay. Looks a bit funny, but very effective pose or mudra, wherein it works on all the thymus glands. So again, people who have thyroid, very good for them. It's very good for children because it works on increasing and honing their communication skills, because you're working on the throat chakra. There's a throat chakra. You're working on that. So it helps in increasing your communication skill, your confidence. So it's very good when you do it with your kids. It's all the more good for them. For adults, it's very good to remove the pent up emotions. Now, most of the times we just don't talk about our emotions or we just keep it inside. Okay. But when we do this Siha Mudra, it's a subtle way of releasing the pent up emotions in your mind. Okay. So when I was doing my yoga course, you know, when we were doing this mudra, there were many foreigners who used to do this and just cry because there, you know, they don't have anyone to share. Here, at least we talk to our people and then we share, but there we don't share that much. But when they used to do this mudra, after this, they used to just keep crying because their emotions have come out, which is actually a good thing. Rather than keeping it inside and exploding it someday, it's always good to vent it out. Okay, so let's do that. I'll show it to you first. You keep your palms on your knees. Now, when you get into this position, you automatically get that little bit of, you know, what do you say, strength. Okay, so that's the reason we keep it, our palms planted on the knees. Okay, you look straight, you inhale out your tongue. So I'm exhaling through throat and gazing at the tip of my nose. Okay, so let's do it together 3 times. Okay, so let's inhale. 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 And relax. If you do it for, you know, 7 to 10 times, you'll actually start feeling so lighter in your heart. Okay? Because it's a way of just expressing out everything without communicating anything. Okay? It's just letting out those emotions out or venting out. Okay? It's also very good for the stale carbon dioxide. You know, there's so much of stale carbon dioxide that gets accumulated here because we never exhale out completely. Our exhalation is so shallow that, you know, there's so much of stale carbon dioxide over this area. And when you do this, it helps in removing that too. Okay. So great. So now you know the 5 asanas that you need to do. Malasana, if your knees are strong. Do that every day. Start from tomorrow itself when you drink water, just get into that asana and do it. Okay. The next eye exercises, yes, please incorporate it every day. Okay. You can just do it while watching TV also. Okay. But please, please do it because eyes are the organs that are mostly and badly affected due to our exposure to the digital devices. Okay. And one of this breathing, Siha Mudra. Okay, again, very good to remove out all the emotions. Very good for the kids to increase their communication and confidence skills. Okay, now we'll conclude the session. Okay, before we get into a question and answer session. So for that, you can again just sit in any comfortable position. Get your hands in Gyan Mudra, the way we started. Just rest it on your knees. Take a few moments to close your eyes and observe yourself internally. See how you're feeling. See if there are any changes within yourself after the session. Now let's conclude by chanting Om. When we chant Om at the end of the session, it means we are offering our gratitude, okay, to the universe, to yoga, okay. And also it means when we get up from the mat, we are not just practicing the yoga practices while we are on the mat, but also off the mat, okay, we take our yoga practice, okay. So let's sit erect, spine erect, hands in Gyan Mudra. Close your eyes. We'll chant Om 3 times. Okay. So inhale. Om. relax. Slowly open your eyes. Release your mudra, hand posture, hand gesture. Warm your palms. Transfer this energy to your eyes. Face, neck, arms, chest, abs, back, legs. Thank your body. Talk to your body in the language which it understands, the language of love and gratitude. That's what your body understands. Now stretch your arms over your head and just pull yourself up. From here, let's just get into a gratitude mudra. Just be here for a few seconds. Surrender mudra, Sharanagat mudra. Let's surrender to our parents, God, Mother Earth, nature. Let's express gratitude for all the things that we have in our lives. Let's thank our bodies for supporting us. I and team of Sense 22 Yoga, thank you for being part of this yoga family. Bhavatu Sarva Mangalam. Let the peace prevail throughout the universe. And relax. Thank you so much. Thanks for being here with us. And I'm sure you'll do the asanas that we have practiced in this session. Thank you. Namaste. Over to you, Shailesh.
Aparna, it was very, very phenomenal. I'm sure a lot of people will watch this video again and again. The beautiful part about your presentation was the simplicity with which you explained each and every aspect, asanas and mudras. Another beautiful part about the 1 hour session is the explanations which you gave, the reasonings behind the why it should be done. I think this is something which we will never forget. And maybe that is one point on which we'll all be working on. One of the best part about this session was you have such a vast experience. However, you have appealed to every type, age group of the audience which we have. And that's something which is requires great skills. So thank you so much, Aparna. It was very insightful. In fact, a lot of things which maybe we were practicing, we did not know the reasons behind it, yeah, or maybe the right way of doing it. And we now know that there is a lot of thought behind every asanas and mudras. So from the bottom of my heart, on behalf of Sense 22, really, it was a very great session, Aparna.
Thank you. My complete pleasure.
I'm sure we cannot compel you to extend the session, but we have one point on which we will extend the session is by a few question and answers kind of we will do. It's something which every sadhaka, every seeker has is. And there's a lot of quick fixes available in the universe, you know, of yoga. And yoga is such a vast universe. I mean, it's like at the end of every yogi also is still exploring. So how is our quick fixes like 5 asanas, 3 mudras will be really applicable to really transform ourselves and get into the health mode?
Okay. Yeah. So I get your question. Now in this today's world, you know, wherein we have fast food, we have Swiggies, we have BeFast, and so many, you know, applications that we have, wherein, you know, everything is accessible so easily for all of us. Right. Okay. And anything is accessible. Okay. So yes, the quick fixes, they are not only over there, but definitely in our yoga family, there are quick fixes like the five asanas. And I'm relating it to the five asanas because you have seen, you know, it hardly takes any time. Okay.
Absolutely.
So if you're pressed for the time, morning when you get up, you are done with your regular activities, just do it and you're done within, you know, 25 minutes or 30 minutes. Okay. Just within a half an hour, you're just done with this five asanas and a little bit of breathing. Okay. And it's like, you know, you have started the day right. You have set the tone for the day. And then you're ready to take anything that comes for the day. Okay.
Great.
So, and apart from the asanas, you know, the breathing, which is so powerful, you know, hardly 5 minutes deep breathing if you do, you know, you're giving your body what it needs the most. It's just asking for oxygen, oxygen, oxygen and love. Nothing else. Okay. So of 5 or 10 minutes of deep breaths, sitting in one position, closing your eyes, internalizing yourself, just observe your breath, your incoming breath and the outgoing breath, or just few deep breaths, you know. So this quick fixes, yes, definitely helps, definitely works. And these are so handy. You can also do it, you know, the breathing part. You can also do it when you're traveling, when you're in the car. Okay. So yes, quick fixes do work, but also understand that it's not every time quick fixes work. You know, there are few things which requires you to put in a lot of efforts, and persistence is the key. Okay. And that time, yes, you have to engage that much of time and put in the efforts. But the five asanas that I shared, or the little bit of deep breathing and a little bit of mindfulness throughout the day, those quick fixes definitely work from yoga perspective.
Perfect, perfect, Aparna. I think I'm sure the viewers will understand that setting the tone for the day is very, very critical, because today we make a lot of decisions, and in the pandemic times with the stresses around us, our tone, our internal peace is much, much, much important. Here, Aparna, I want to ask, you know, how do we manage time? I'm sure, I mean, managing time is something where you're saying you can manage time. Time is much bigger a thing than us. I mean, it's like you're how do we create time or manage time, whatever we say in simple terms? Because a lot of people tend to slip, you know, they start for 3-4 days and then they said, okay, fine, let me take a break. However, is it so compulsory that we do it every day, or is it that, what is that which we say it's really practice so that it can make a tangible change in our physique, the way we think and way we communicate with the society?
Okay. So when you're asking this question, a thought came to my mind. I read it somewhere, not my thought. The bad news is that time flies. But the good news is that we are the pilot. Okay. So everything is in our control, right? We know what's important for us. Okay. So doing the most important thing first in the morning, it's like, you know, you're done with the most important thing right at the most productive time of the day. Okay. And then you focus on other things. But for that, you need to identify what is that most important thing for you. If it's health, get done with this five asanas in half an hour. Okay. So now again, sorry, I'm relating everything to five asanas, but that's the way I can, you know, actually let you know how we need to do. So if it's health, just complete this in half an hour. If it's a reading, if you feel, you know, that's the thing which interests you, or you think that sets the tone for the day, just first time of the day, just do that. So whatever is important for you, just do that first thing in the morning, and then leave the other things for the rest of the day. And you know, again, I know, as Mozart said, if you have to do many things at a time, the only way to do is to do one thing at a time. Now this again links back to yoga, wherein you are mindful. Now when we are talking, we are mindful. I'm talking to Shailesh, I'm talking to so many of the people over there who are listening to me. Okay. So be mindful, be present in that moment, give it 100% shot, and then you will see how efficiently and how quickly that thing gets done.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So it's more of prioritizing what is important for you, doing it first thing in the morning. Okay. And keep doing it. Again, persistence comes here. It's not that key, you did it for a day and then you are done. No, that persistence is the key that needs to be there. And one thing which, again, I feel, it's not managing the time, it's investing in the time. If you invest in the time, your time will be nicely managed. So take it from that perspective.
Right. I think a couple of more questions, Aparna. And The one question which comes to our mind is, see, you always had a profession and you were in IT and then you went into yoga and that's what's your passion today. A lot of people get into the struggle of finding that passion or pursuing that passion. Any tips for them, Aparna?
Let me tell you, Shailesh and everyone, if your passion and profession is same, life is so beautiful. And I am a live example of it. Okay. I'm blessed to have that passion and profession as a single thing. Okay. So now again here, you know, you need to identify your passion and that you will get to know only through you when you are spending some time with yourself. Okay. So first identify that passion. Second thing, what I would say is, at least once a week, devote a day and a time for that passion. Like you can do something for that passion. You can hone your skills. You can learn new things which are basically related to that passion. Okay. And keep on improving yourself. Because when you're doing things that you're passionate about, you feel so much involved in it. Okay. So that's the thing. And the third thing, you know, which most of us do, and even I do sometimes, is procrastination. Stop it. Just take one step towards your passion and see how the entire universe helps you in achieving your set intentions and passions. You know, just take that one step ahead and all the things get sorted out. You know, so I think these are the three things which we really need to do if we want to get into that passion of ours.
Great, Aparna. Thanks for sharing these tips, very important for all of us. And we will continue to have your sessions in the coming months. We'll create a kind of a series based upon the feedback from our viewers. And I'm sure this 1 hour, I'm sure a lot of people will watch it again and again and practice it because it was very sharp, very intelligent. And there is a certain sense of humility with which you explain, which I want to personally express for this session.
Thank you.
So thank you so much, Aparna. With this, I want to also introduce our next yogi on the 31st of January. So we have Sanjay Kumar Chaudhary, an amazing personality because he is kind of an ambassador of yoga on behalf of the Indian Council of Cultural Relationships. He's also part of the Consulate General of India, Bali, and he is an expert and a graduate from the Swami Vivekananda Cultural Center. He is also certified as one of the toppers from the Ayush department in his yoga practice. He's a master degree in yoga. And he was one of the lead international when we started our yoga outreach at the around the world. And he was at Bangkok. He was also at Bali. And he has close to a decade of experience in teaching yoga. What Sanjay will bring to the session is he is amazingly process oriented. Because he represents kind of a structured program on behalf of the country as a part of our yoga outreach around the world. And he has a lot of responsibilities in imparting what we meant by yoga or mean by yoga to the world community. So I'm pretty excited to, I'm sure all will be to have Sanjay Kumar Chaudhary on the 31st of January. And we'll continue this series, Aparna. I think it's getting more and more exciting because yoga is a universe and capturing that in 1 hour and for the entire year, it's going to be pretty exciting. Thank you so much for every viewer who has been here. And Aparna, you've got some amazing comments from your networks and communities and friends and for Sense 22 Yoga. Thank you so much.
Thanks, sir. Have a good day.
Good day. Namaste.